Random House Audio presents In Montmartre, Picasso, Matisse, and Modernism in Paris, 1900 to 1910, by Sue Roe. Read for you by Emma Bering. Introduction. Inside the glowing red simulated windmill, the girls danced the can-can to Offenbach's deafening music, tossing their heads, their petticoats raised in a froth of white as they kicked their legs, revealing tantalizing glimpses of black and scarlet. They performed on the dance floor, mingling with the punters, aristocrats, celebrities, artists, boulevardiers, and strangers. In those days, there was no raised platform in the Moulin Rouge. In the daytime, on a stage rigged up in the gardens outside, there were open-air performances of singing and dancing, including makeshift ballets danced by the young Montmartroises, everyone still called the Little Rats. To the side of the stage stood a model elephant, an incongruous exhibit left over from the 1889 World Fair, which housed the orchestra. It was at night, however, that the place really came into its own. When young Pablo Picasso arrived in Paris in October 1900, he made his way up the hillside of Montmartre to the lodgings he was borrowing from another Catalan artist before heading down to investigate the nightlife. At first, he was dismayed by the Moulin Rouge, finding it tinselly and expensive in comparison with the all-male taverns of Barcelona. He had been expecting artistic bohemia, not cavorting women. His Catalan friends, habitués of Montmartre, usually gathered at the top of the hillside, around the Place du Tertre, preferring the shady, cramped little bars where they could drink and talk until dawn. Up there, in the heights of Montmartre, Picasso discovered the other, less outrageous popular dance hall, the old Moulin de la Galette, a real converted windmill where the neighborhood girls and their beaux still danced into the small hours as they had in Renoir's day. Here, artists such as Henri Matisse and the Dutch painter Kees van Dongen, whose portraits of women with elongated limbs, monocles, and short haircuts would later earn him a central place among modernist artists, went to sketch the dancers. Nevertheless, it was not long before Picasso succumbed to the allure of the cabarets at the foot of the Butte, where prostitutes spilled out into the streets, strolling along the boulevards. They were among his first Parisian subjects. A Spaniard, Joseph Oler, had created the Moulin Rouge on the site of the old Reine Blanche. Ingeniously, he constructed it in the shape of a windmill, competition for the old place at the top of the hillside, with eye-catching sails and red electric lighting, opening it under its new name in 1889. He commissioned a painting by Toulouse-Lautrec for the foyer and poached the dancers with the best legs from the Élysée Montmartre. From the day it opened, the red windmill became Montmartre's most popular attraction, even in summertime. When Parisians left the city for their country retreats, visitors came in from all over the world, gravitating towards Montmartre in search of cheap cabaret entertainment and lively nightlife. Behind the scenes, the Moulin Rouge traded prostitutes, but the visitors and their wives who patronized it saw only the surface gaiety and glamour of the place, enjoying the atmosphere of risque sensuality without taking any real risk. As for the performers, they were unforgettable. La Goulue, queen of the French can-can, belted out songs celebrating the lowlife of Montmartre. Her replacement, Jeanne Avril, had been treated for hysteria by neurologist Jean-Martin Charcot in his clinic at the Salpêtrière Mental Hospital before dancing in nightclubs on the left bank. She later grew bored of these and came to Montmartre, where she shook off her inhibitions in the Moulin Rouge, spindly legs flying in all directions. She was not interested in material things, she once said, only in l'amour. The poor, the displaced, those who had known destitution, deprivation, and suffering, seemed to find a natural home for their talents in Montmartre. The district was already suffused with its own distinctive melancholy. Higher up the hillside, up the narrow steps, past the small tree-lined squares, windmills still stood among the gardens and vineyards that covered the steep slopes. Though they no longer milled flour, it was to these that the Butte owed its distinctive, fragile beauty, immortalized in the sketches of Van Gogh, who briefly lived there during the 1880s and painted the view from his attic window in shades of grayish blue. In later years, Picasso looked back with nostalgia on Montmartre, where he lived out the formative years of his career and established the emotional foundations of his work. "My inner self," he once said, "is bound to be in my canvas, since I'm the one doing it. Whatever I do, it'll be there. In fact, there'll be too much of it. It's all the rest that's the problem." The 10 years following his arrival in Paris, he painted the world of Montmartre, seen through the prism of his inner life, responding, too, to the emotions and ideas of those who converged on the place during the first decade of the 20th century. Matisse, André Derain, Maurice de Vlaminck, Van Dongen, Modigliani, couturier Paul Poiret, and writer Gertrude Stein, each of whom became his friend. They were all inspired by the world of Montmartre, responding to the mood of artistic self-consciousness which had replaced the decadence of the Belle Époque and came to characterize the modern age. All the rest, the plethora of challenges set by the changing social climate, their awareness of the art of the past, the technical demands presented by their rapidly emerging ideas, would increasingly make claims on them. During the first decade of the 20th century, art, as well as entertainment, was profoundly influenced by travelers and outsiders. Artists from Spain, Italy, Russia, and America converged on Montmartre, providing entertainment, inspiration, and fresh social interaction. Newcomers to the artistic scene were brought together by an unlikely nexus of brilliant talents, including Gertrude Stein, Paul Poiret, and art dealer Ambroise Vollard. And the decade saw the formation of a new avant-garde. In the village environment at the top of the hillside, in muddy lanes and broken-down shacks, inspired by the circus and silent movies, close to the locals, still dancing the night away in the old Moulin de la Galette, the leading artists of the 20th century spent their early years living among acrobats, dancers, prostitutes, and clowns. Their spontaneity, libertine lifestyles, and love of popular culture contributed to the bohemian ambiance of Au Montmartre and to the development of path-breaking ideas. By the end of the decade, Matisse was exhibiting his dynamic works, La Danse and La Musique. Picasso had shocked his friends with Les Demoiselles d'Avignon. Poiret was dressing Le Tout Paris in garments inspired by the costumes worn by the performers in the Ballet Russe production of Rimsky-Korsakov's Scheherazade. And every gallery in Paris was showing Cubist art. How did all this come about? The decade saw the emergence of major artistic discoveries as well as significant social change. In the years following the end of the Belle Époque, young artists weary of decadence and satire were already looking for new subjects and novel, more rigorous methods of painting which reflected their feelings about their lives. As an incomer, Picasso was fascinated by what he saw around him. Itinerant circus performers and acrobats, streetwalkers, and the day-to-day life of those who lived in the shanty town that was the northern flank of Montmartre. At the foot of the Butte, dramatic shifts were beginning to take place in the world of entertainment. During the years immediately following 1900, cinema took over from the circus as a major recreational diversion, and its progression from circus venues to designated spaces and the transition from the earliest silent movies to motion pictures with narrative, featuring popular screen stars, were also profoundly influential. The artists who gathered in Montmartre modeled themselves, for fun, on film stars and comic book heroes. In retrospect, it seems that, If the Impressionists had sought to capture on canvas a moment in time, the natural world en passant. By contrast, in Montmartre between 1900 and 1910, there was a spirit of iconoclasm at work. With the rise of photography as an artistic medium, the painter's previous ambition.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.